Okay, so just to remind ourselves, what we've been working on is something called a list. A list or an ordered data structure. We've seen one way to implement them so far that uses an array to store the object references in the list and also uses the array to establish the position of each item in the list. But that's not the only way that we can do this. And the cool thing about lists and the reason why there are several different list implementations in the Java standard library is that different list implementations turn out to be good at different things. If an array list was the right solution for every problem, that would be the only implementation that you would find in the Java standard library, but it's not. And so what we're going to do is we're going to explore this other approach, and then we're also going to look at the trade-offs, which is super fun. Okay, so let's look at this. This is the list interface that we've been working on implementing. This is a simplified version of Java's list interface. It's got a get and a set, add, remove. So get and set are operations that should be familiar to us from our work with arrays. Add and remove are what is new. That's the things that allow us to either increase or decrease the size of the list, which is something that we can't do with an array. All right, so here's how this is going to work roughly. And this is our other approach, which is to use linkage. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to kind of walk you through what happens when we add things to the front of the list. So just to be able to bootstrap things, our goal first is going to be to work on get and set, because add and remove turn out to be a little bit more complicated. But it turns out that there's one case of add that's quite simple. So let me show you how that works. That's adding to the front of the list. We'll have to finish a more general implementation of add later, but adding to the front is actually pretty straightforward. So let's see how this works. So here's my item class. And each item class in my list is responsible for two things. First of all, it stores a reference to the value that is stored at that position in the list. And then it also stores a next reference to the next item in the list. Notice that the item doesn't know where it is in the list. It doesn't know if it's the first item or the last item. And that's actually important because that changes over time. All it knows is two things. It knows the reference of the current value that's stored there. And then it knows how to find the next item if there is one. So let's look at how to add stuff to the front. Okay, so I'm doing this in a slightly different way than we'll do it in our implementation. But let's see what happens. So I've created this variable items that is a reference to an item, and I've initialized it to refer to an item that stores as an object the integer 0 and then null as its next reference. So at this point, items is a reference to the start of the list and it has one element. Okay, so let's see how to add an item. I just did it. That's it. I added an item. It's like, what black magic is this? So let's look at it carefully. This is a place where we got to go through the assignment step by step. Going back to school, this is how we used to do things. So right side of this, okay? When the right side starts running, what is items? Items, when the right side starts to run, refers to this item with value 0, okay? So that's what gets used as the next reference for this new item that I'm creating that's going to store the value 8, okay? So I start running the constructor for item. I pass in as the next the current value of items, which refers to the item with value 0. That creates a new item object where the next reference refers to the item with value 0. I set the value there to 8, and then the reference that I get to this new item overwrites the old value of items. So I take the right side, remember, assignment right to left, old school, right side first, evaluate the right side, and then I save it into that item's variable, which now stores a reference to the new item that was created. So see what just happened there? The list, which had one item, now has two items, and the place where I inserted the item is at the front, okay? This is the easiest place to put something in a list and in a linked list. And when we build our linked list, we'll create a constructor that uses this to initialize the list from an array. And that's really useful for us. It just, otherwise there's no way to create a list. It's just like you end up with an empty list and then it's not very useful. So, okay, let's do it again. Ready? Just add another item. Again, same thing. Right side first. What is items when the right side starts to run? It's a reference to the item with value 8. So that gets set as the next reference for this new item that I'm creating that has value 5. When after Java constructs that new item, it saves a reference to it into the reference variable items. And so now I have a list with 3 elements, 5, 8, 0, And when I add things in this way, they go at the front. And so when we actually use this to initialize our list from an array, we'll actually flip the array around to go through it backwards so the items end up in the right order. Okay, so let's go back and let's look at this one more time. So here's my item class. I know this is tricky, right? This sort of reference magic that we're going to start doing, but becoming comfortable with this is really important because we're going to be doing more of this soon. So here's my item class. Each item class stores two things, value, which is the data that's stored in the list, and then this next reference to another item, and that's the linkage that we establish so that we know where things are in the list and we can find all the items. So first thing, I set items to this new item that I created with initially a next reference null. This is the end of the list at this point. So the last item in the list always has a next reference null. When I go through the list, that's how I'm going to know that I'm at the end. Initial value 0. Okay, so this actually for a lot of people probably makes sense. It's like, oh, okay, well, this is just, I just used a constructor and I saved a reference into a reference variable, whatever, big deal. This is where things start to get weird. Right side first. What does items refer to when the right side starts to execute? It refers to an item with value 0. That's what gets set at as the next reference in this new item that I'm about to create that has value 8. Once that constructor finishes running, the new reference gets stored to the left and overwrites items. So items now refers to this new item that was created with item 8 with value 8, but its next reference refers to the first item I created with item 0. Run this again and the same thing happens. I put a new item at the front of the list. So this single line of code with a linked list is sufficient to add an item at the front. And that's something that we're going to utilize so that we can build a list in our constructor.